Shalom. This is Ras Alonso Tafari, reporting for the Land of Judah Society. It's on Tuesday, July 26, 2016. It's 3:36 a.m. Now, we're gonna try to bring this forth and just stick to the program. So, let's see. Let's begin with the Book of Numbers. There's a couple enumerations that we'd like to bring forth. One apparently took place in the wilderness of Sinai. Let's see, a reference to this would be the Book of Numbers, chapter 26, verse 64. But among these, there was not a man of them whom Moses and Aaron, the priests, numbered when they numbered the children of Israel in the wilderness of Sinai. Fine, that's that. There is a second enumeration which we learn about. It's also in the Book of Numbers. Reference is chapter 26, verse 63. To my surprise, I was trying to look for it in another place. Anyways, it reads, "These are they that were numbered by Moses and Eleazar, not by Moses and Aaron. These were numbered by Moses and Eleazar, the priest, who numbered the children of Israel in the plains of Moab by Jordan near Jericho." That's a second enumeration. Fine. What is it that we're trying to bring forth? I forgot, actually. I think this is about the Kenizzites. Ethiopia, really. Anyways, now, Numbers chapter 32, verse. My bad, I kind of skipped something. Caleb and Joshua, which is the theme, the principal theme. Numbers chapter 26, verse 65. To my surprise, this is right next to, I've had these three verses like right next to each other and not even aware of it. So it says, is that correct? Yeah, I think it is. Oh, 65, my bad. So it reads, "And for the Lord had said of them, they shall surely die in the wilderness. And there was not left a man of them, save Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, and Joshua, the son of Nun." So, let us go forward. I'm going to try not to even add any commentary. I just want to get this over with. It's kind of late, or early, for that matter. The Book of Numbers, chapter 32, verse 11 to 12. "Surely none of the men that came up out of Egypt from 20 years old and upward shall see the land which I swear to Abraham and to Isaac and to Jacob, because they have not wholly followed me, save Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite, and Joshua, the son of Nun, for they have wholly followed the Lord." I think it's only proper to bring forth that, tied into this is both rods. The rod of Ephraim and the rod of Judah. I'm tempted to do something. I'm tempted to just say something. You know what the connection is? It's in the Book of Exodus, chapter 17, towards the end. There's a hidden throne right there. There's a hidden throne in the last verse, the which is not translated in the English, but it is in the Amharic and it is in the Spanish. But there's something interesting about that section. It gets my attention. What could I say? Watch, this is what we would like to say concerning that. You've seen that picture where, Mariam, he's got Jesus as a child upon her lap. That's, imagine that. When Moses is on the top of the hill, Joshua and his elect are fighting the Amalekites in the valley. And then on top of the hill is Moses stretching forth his arms, like Ethiopia Psalm 68, verse 31, if I'm not mistaken, stretching forth her arms with the branch in his arm or with the rod. You know that it's a sign of the rod because he did say, I go up with the rod of God up to the mount or to the top of the hill. But how could he be holding the rod if his hands are stretched forth? And then he's got Hur representing the tribe of Judah to one side, and he's got Aaron representing the Levites on the other side. How could that be? If it, well, there's a hidden rod, even there's a missing link, and it's not Lucy, you know. So, but it is Ethiopia. It does have to do with Ethiopia. So he's on a rock. So he's sitting on a foundation. On this foundation has the Lord sworn that his throne shall be because of the burden, because of the nature of man, we could say. In this order of battle shall we war against Amalekites, you know, from generation to generation. So there's some hidden elements concerning that. But upon that foundation the throne will be laid, that until you receive in the heavens clarification, then you will be able to see manifested on the earth. But you're not able to see what's the throne that's always been on earth, because your heaven is distorted, because you're wicked. You just don't want to accept what is, because it's not any kind of problem, but a God problem. You just don't want to accept that he is true and faithful, and that his word is fulfilled, because then we can't pick and choose to our liking and our own benefit. So that makes it too real, it makes it too true, it makes it too much like something we don't want to have to do with, because we like it in Egypt. It's a very comfortable, you know. So now, what are we trying to look for? Trying to look for this psalm. There's something interesting in the Amharic concerning that which we were just mentioning. I can't find it. For some reason, it was right here the whole time. My bad. So, Chane is used, and it's referring to the load, burden. And the interesting thing is that Chene or Chene, it means lap or thigh. There's really no major difference between Chane and Chene. Yeah. Aside from the vocalization of the vowel accompanying the consonant, which form a father-son covenant within each, you know, symbol representation in the Afro-Semitic, you know, like Amarnya Kwankwa, or language, you know, speech, which is interesting. Chane, Chene, lap or thigh or load. So what I'm trying to say is that upon the lap of Moses is the spirit, is the son that is to be born of that woman. Because Moses is not Moses. You see, Moses is soul. Ethiopia stretching forth her hands is the body, is the woman. And the burden is a light thing. Even a light child. It's a light savior. Reminds us of this, you know. Of this video, War with the Lion of Judah. Anyways, so Moses has, it's a picture of like, of everything. Without Ethiopia stretching forth their hand, if you don't accept the woman that bring forth that man-child, and that woman is the body of Moses, except there's a veil, so we can't see that. That's why Joshua and his elect are fighting in the valley, while we all connected, Aaron the priesthood, one half of the blessing, and then of the birthright, and then Hur, tribe of Judah on the other side, but in the center is Moses, the called savior, and he's carrying a burden. But then also Chane, load, and Chane and Chen, it's, you know, if we want to just, you know, play with the words, it's like lap or thigh. What's in his lap or thigh? His child, because Moses is not Moses. Moses is the soul. His body, which would be what's represented, is Ethiopia, because he married Zipporah, the Ethiopian. And so that in itself is very interesting. So we're going to go forth to, you know, to the planned curriculum that we had set forth. Now, Why did I say that? Because it has everything to do with this. Caleb and Joshua, these two are representations of Ephraim and Judah. Now, where does the priest, the Levitical priesthood come in? How why is it not represented in the rods? Well, because the priesthood was only like a intermission work, intermediatory work, let's buy time, job buying time until the Ethiopian work was perfected, until it was fulfilled. That's all it was. It wasn't supposed to be to the tribe of the priesthood was not supposed to stay, within the confines of with the tribe of the Levites. It was only a just a moment in time until the work was made manifest. That's what that is. So it wasn't never supposed to like last forever. It was just for the time being. Until, the promise reached to whom it was given. Going forward, this is how we're gonna connect everything. Watch. Book of Numbers, chapter 26, verse 65. Did we read that already? I think we read that already. All right, let's go forward. Chapter, we read the next thing we have here in our notes. So these two witnesses are the same two witnesses that originally came out of Egypt that were 20 years and older, Caleb and Joshua. So now let us go forward to the book of Numbers. We're still in the book of Numbers, chapter 34. Check this out. Chapter 34, verse 17 to 19, the which read, "These are the names of the men which shall divide the land to you, Eleazar the priest, and Joshua the son of Nun. And ye shall take one prince of every tribe to divide the land by inheritance. And the names of the men are these: of the tribe of Judah, Caleb the son of Jephunneh." Keep that in consideration. It's very, very, very significant. Having said that, let us go forward to the book of still within the book of Numbers, chapter 13. Chapter 13, verses 11 to 11 to 11 to 12. Of the tribe of Joseph, namely the tribe of Manasses. Wait, what am I doing? Did I write this wrong? Let's see, the book of Numbers. I'm obviously a little bit sleepy. I excuse myself for that, but there's no excuse. The book of Numbers, chapter 13, verse 8. Of the tribe of Ephraim, Hosea, the son of Nun. Now we're going to go forward to, let's see, verse 16 to clarify that a little bit. These are the names of the men which Moses sent to spy out the land. And Moses called Hosea, the son of Nun, Yehoshua, later on, mentioned as Joshua. So Caleb, son of Jephunneh, is prince, of the tribe of Judah. Joshua, Yehoshua, once Hosea before, Moses changed his name. He is son of Nun of the tribe of Ephraim. Let's go forward to the book of Genesis, chapter 41. We could just summarize all this, but then we would actually take longer, to be honest. Because we'd go on talking and talking and talking. And what we want to do is just bring forth this evidence to which it has to be recognized. Chapter 41, book of Genesis, verse 45 to 50. Or verse 45 and 50. Joseph, rejected by his brethren, receives a Gentile bride, a body. In this case, an Egyptian body. And Pharaoh called Joseph's name Zaphnath-Paaneah, and he gave him to wife Asenath, the daughter of Potipharah, priest of On. And Joseph went out over all the land of Egypt. Now, verse 50 would be, and Joseph, and to Joseph were born two sons before the years of famine came, which Asenath, the daughter of Potipharah, priest of On, bear to him, you know, Manasseh and Ephraim. Man, there's so many things that must be said about this. You know what Zaphnath-Paaneah means in the, like, the Egyptians, they used to say that the savior of the world. You know what it says? Well, the note here says in the Coptic, but in the Hebrew, it's the revealer of secrets. This should give us an idea of the kind of attitude we should not have. So the Egyptians say, you know, that Zaphnath Paaneah is like, oh, Joseph, the savior of the world. Cool. But you know, the attitude amongst the Hebrews is like, oh, you know, the teller of secrets, the one that tells the animals or the normal people the things that make us special. That kind of attitude is what got us into the situation we in, for the record. Peter, thou shalt not call any man unclean. Stop calling people animals. Stop considering other people flocks, because then you're going to be treated like a flock. Think about it. Something to think about. And I'm not playing, you know. Both Jew and Gentile, Greek and Jew have proven to govern for themselves. And both have proven to be as wicked as ones could be, one towards the other, even amongst oneselves. So that's part of the lesson that we must learn. No one's better. No one. Going forward, it's interesting because the priesthood is actually a worldly thing. Do you think it's any surprise that Joseph married the daughter, Asenath, the daughter of Potiphar, priest of On? Why? Because priestly rights are a thing of a firstborn. They cannot be changed, they cannot be updated. The number is sealed, it is always intact, nor no less, no more. That is why the firstborn, in order for there to be a birthright allotted to the children of Israel, then the firstborns that have received that birthright by birth in the natural sense must die to make space for that blessing to be laid upon those who are the recipients, which are in turn the replacement to those that have sacrificed their lives in order to give up that birthright. So the reason why Joseph marries the daughter of Asenath, it's to gain a legitimate priesthood through the priest of On, Potipharah's daughter. Then Joseph's inheritance, which he then transfers on to Yaakov by the will of the Almighty, then that becomes the legitimate priesthood, the right of a priesthood. Because the priesthood was not limited to Israel prior to Israel. Israel is just a new thing. Before Israel, every firstborn male of every family was endowed with the birthright. And then it was limited to Shem. And then it was limited to Abraham. And then it was limited to, so we see the pattern here. But it's no surprise that it just so happens that Moses marries the daughter of Jethro, priest of Midian. You see the connection? So now, going forward, let's see what we got here in our notes. Genesis chapter 48, that's going to talk about how, you know, Jah promised certain things to Jacob, and well, behold, through Ephraim, all is fulfilled. And now, just to add to this, I've said before, split and flip, you know, divide the hoof or split the hoof and then chew the cud. That rule applies. This is one example. Who is the firstborn? son of Joseph. Flipped script, or script flipped. It's not Joseph's son. Hey, Joseph, guess what? Through your children, they're actually mine, like Reuben and Shimon, and through my children, Jah's promise is fulfilled to me. So whatever you have after that, that's yours. You know, so the script has been flipped, or it's a flip scripter, but in the clean way. And now, okay, let me bless my children. So, you know, he brings forth the children. No, what are you doing? You can't bless Ephraim. You got the wrong one. Manasseh is the firstborn. I know. But now I'ma divide the work. Now I'ma flip it, or flip it and divide it. You know, I didn't think about how to set that in order. But there's a flip. There's a twist to the matter. You know, there's a division, and then there's a, well, it's divided. They're no longer your children. They're mine. So that's a division. They're circumcised, to be mine. And then, well, the firstborn is not going to be the firstborn. The firstborn will be the secondborn. And the secondborn, I will bless with the firstborn, right? It's for it to be a clean work, you know? Split the hoof and chew the cud. Split and flip. So we see this throughout the whole Bible. Anyways, just utilizing the opportunity to bring forth that example so that ones could understand a little bit better what we were talking about when we mentioned that. Now going forward, this is where we're going to include the Kenizzites, which in turn, in reality, at one point in time, they should be recognized as Ethiopians, refined. Well, Ethiopian perhaps is a refined Kenizzite, a possession the which we have acquired, the which has been converted and eventually assimilated to the point where they are no different than a full-born, you know, Israelite. Now, to get to that, we gotta just make a brief mention of the fact that notice how the Ephraim is the rod, is one of the birthrights, is half of the birthright of Jacob, through the which he, you know, he will reign like all nations and stuff like that. So that means that he's a convert in a way. That means that he's half. Because his mom's Egyptian, and his father is spiritual, it's Israel. So, what's going on? You know, the rod has already gone to a people that is a mixed people. A mix between Ham and Shem. So now, and that is, you know, concerning Joshua, because his father is known of the tribe of Ephraim, according to what we read earlier. So now let us learn a little bit more about Caleb. See that whole story. The book of Joshua. Is it Joshua? The book of Joshua. Chapter 14. Verse 6. Let's see. Which reads, then the children of Judah came to Joshua in Gilgal, and Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite, said to him, thou knowest the thing that the Lord said to Moses, the man of God, concerning me and thee in Kadesh Barnea. Now you're going to skip a few verses, go forward on to verse 13. And Joshua blessed him, and gave to Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, Hebron for an inheritance. Hebron therefore became the inheritance of Caleb, the son of Jephunneh the Kenizzite, to this day, because that he wholly followed the Lord God of Israel. And the name of Hebron before was Kirjat Arba, which Arba was a great man among the Anakims, and the land had rest from war. Now let us just go forward onto the same book of Joshua, chapter 15, verse 13. And to Caleb the son of Jephunneh he gave a part among the children of Judah, according to the commandment of the Lord to Joshua, even the city of Arba, the father of Anak, which city is Hebron. And Caleb drove thence the three sons of Anak, Sheshai and Ahiman, and Talmai, the children of Anak. And he went up thence to the inhabitants of Debir, and the name of Debir before was Kirjath Sefer. And Caleb said, He that smiteth Kirjath Sefer and taketh it, to him I will give Achsah, my daughter, to wife. And Othniel, which means the line of God, the son of Kenaz, the brother of Caleb, interesting, right, took it and gave him Achsah, his daughter, to wife. And it came to pass, as she came to him, that she moved him to ask of her father a field. And she lighted off her ass, and Caleb said to her, What wouldest thou? Who answered, Give me a blessing, for thou hast given me a south land, the queen of the south, perhaps. Give me also springs of water, Leitana, and the nether springs, the valley, upper and lower Ethiopia. This is the inheritance of the tribal children of Judah, according to their families. So, appointed a part, or allotted a part, amongst the tribal children of Judah, then, is the Kenizzites. Now, what does that have to do with Ethiopia? Let us keep reading. Book of Judges, chapter 1. Verse 12 to 20. Let's see. And Caleb said, He that smiteth Kirjath Sefer and taketh it, to him will I give Achsah, my daughter, to wife. And Othniel, the son of Kenaz, Caleb's younger brother, took it, and he gave him Achsah, his daughter, to wife. And it came to pass, when she came to him, that she moved him to ask of her father a field, and she lighted from off her ass, and Caleb said to her, What wilt thou? And she said to him, Give me a blessing, for thou hast given me a south land. Give me also springs of water. And Caleb gave her the upper springs and the nether springs. Oh, that's where we get the fullness of that, the lower and upper Ethiopia, or Egypt. And the children of the Kenite, Moses, man, this is confusing now. See, I knew it. The children of the Kenite, Moses' father-in-law, went up out of the city of palm trees with the children of Judah into the wilderness. Man, there's definitely got to be. So, anyways, it doesn't matter because, like we've read before, in the book of Genesis, chapter 15, verse 19, it says that the Kenites and the Kenizzites shall be given as a possession to Abraham, or to Abraham at that time. So basically what we've seen here is that the consummation, or the consuming, the swallowing up of the Kenites, the Kenizzites, and the Kenites and the Kenizzites through Ethiopia. And so it's like a refinement of these Ethiopians and converting them little by little until, like, Caleb's brother eventually marries what, his sister, or what is it? You know, like, kind of like, it's more than just like what it appears to be. These are kind of just, you know, lawful ways of writing these things down. But basically, it's like the merging of Ethiopia that never parted from the tribes of Israel, to the point where they're no longer Kenites or Kenizzites, but full-blown Hebrew Israelites. Although, because, you know, it's like a soul finding a body. It's the same thing. They mesh, they link. It works out. It's what it is. It's what's supposed to happen. And the children of the Kenite, Moses' father-in-law, went up out of the city of palms with the children of Judah to the wilderness of Judah, which lie in the south of Arad. So now we're gonna go forward onto, let's see, Judges chapter 4, verse 11. Now Heber, the Kenite, which was of the children of Hobab, the father-in-law of Moses, had severed himself from the Kenites and pitched his tent to the plain of Za'anaim, which is by Kadesh. Perhaps, you know, there'll be a link to Kadesh Barnea. But it's very important to see what's going on right here. Heber is a Kenite, which was of the children of Hobab, the father-in-law of Moses. Moses' father-in-law did not have no male offspring. That's why he had seven daughters. And the queen of Sheba was the one that would take care of Jethro's flock. And so when an Egyptian that came out, a prince, an Egyptian prince which came out of Egypt, when Zipporah made this known to Jethro, the priest of Midian, Jethro was like, why isn't he here? Go look for him. Why didn't you call him? Call him so that we can break bread, so that we could study Torah. Don't you know that I don't have male lineage? Otherwise, you wouldn't be out there. It is not proper for you to take care of my flock. But I have no sons. Bring them so I can give them to you. Anyways, so that's what eventually happens. Hobab is a code word. Hobab means like cover, darkness, like in the heart. Hobab, you know, I'd have to look that up again, but that's what it means, like secret. It's like in his heart. So what was in the heart? His children, the same children he had in his lap when he was on that mount, you know, representing the fact that he's the soul, and Ethiopia stretching forth their hands to God, connecting the two rods, the two, making them into one through the child that is born, Lich Tefer, in the spirit. You know, Yeshua is with this chosen in the valley, you know, fighting the Amalekites. So what child is that? Well, you know, symbolically at that point where on top of the rock which Ethiopia was sat, which is in turn the body of Moses, which is alluded to in this is Yahweh's banner, Yehovah Nissi. This is the banner, the pole, the sign, this sign, my throne. I swear on my own self that on this foundation will I lay my throne. So the child, symbolically at that time, is his children, the children of Moses with Zipporah, which he loved, but he had to let go of because he had other responsibilities. Thus, what do? You sign a bill of divorce and you hand over your children to Jethro. So now Jethro can be considered Hobab, the father-in-law of Moses, but his name is not Hobab. His name is many different titles. He's Raguel or Reuel, which is the friend of Jah, which is a title that he received from Abraham, his grandfather. Why? Because Abraham married his body, Keturah, that's Ethiopian, the flesh. Sarah is a representation of the spirit, of the promise. Sarah's not yes, she was black. I'm not going to argue that. But that's not the way that ones are supposed to receive it. The child that Sarah brought forth was of the spirit. It's got to be represented like in a physical form so that we can have a shadow of things to come. But the fullness of it is in spirit and in truth. Are we not spirit and are we not in the flesh? So if we called to the spirit and we inhabit flesh, then doesn't that make us seed of the flesh and the spirit? Yes, it does. So that is how we're supposed to look at it. Keturah is actually Abraham's wife in the flesh. Sarah is his promise. Howbeit the natural things come at first, but the story lays down the spiritual matter concerning that, or relative to what we're talking about, Abraham or Abraham and Sarah, you know. So that's that, the connection. Through Keturah, Abraham had natural seed, which are, you know, in turn, you know, where the Midianites come from. Now, ones might think, okay, we in the study portions, Balak and you know, Phinehas. Well, what do we do about the Midianites, and how come they corrupt? How come they warring against Israel? Well, okay, Book of Genesis, chapter 36. The Midianites were smitten. So the Midianites were under persecution. They too were downpressed. They were colonized. And so things happen. Jethro is priest of Midian. He didn't lose his land because he could think for himself a way to serve Jah. Just like the Egyptians, they all lost everything. Everyone gave everything up to Pharaoh except the priest, because they can feed themselves, they can sustain. They know that the famine has nothing to do with physical food. That's why they're not going to sell their possessions. like if selling, like if trying to buy crack. Even Israel, they got food, they ate it all, and then they came back for more, and they had to sell themselves as slaves because they wanted to restore. Well, in that case, because Jah set it all up, but in a case to avoid falling into Egypt again, we have to realize that you cannot satisfy a spiritual necessity through natural resources. So you're in the promised land and you're hungry. No, you're not hungry. There's not a famine. You're just being greedy. You gotta overcome it. And you gotta train yourself to understand that you cannot depend on physical or material resources, whether it be food or whatever, because those things, go in one way, come out the other way, then you're hungry again. And what, you're gonna keep doing that until you lose it all? No. So sacrifices must be made, and then we will grow. We go down into Egypt, we enslave ourselves, or we carry the burden of the tragedy of our time, which could, appear to be riches, like Hagar. Oh, look at this maid that I got in Egypt. Well, along with your lack of faith, now you're gonna doubt, and you're gonna have an opportunity to actually manifest your doubt. So hey, Abram, this is Sarai speaking. Jai ain't really that powerful. Maybe what he meant was that maybe through my handmaid, we'll have descendants. Because yeah, we went down into Egypt being spiritual and stuff, so we descended down to the valley. Now we're rich in the world, because they gave us all kinds of things to remove the plague that we caused upon them, which doesn't make you any friends, but rather enemies, to which our descendants, somewhere along the line in the future, will have to deal with because of the wrong that we brought upon the valley dwellers. We being spiritual and all, expected to know best, we did worse, and so now Jah plagued them, and so we still blessed. So they definitely gonna hate on us. But now that I got Hagar, why don't you go into Hagar? Maybe that because God, yeah, we don't trust him, so, and he's not that powerful. So why don't you go into her, and maybe that's the way we'll get seed. What happens? Now you gotta put up with Hagar until she's old, until, Ishmael. Then you gotta put up with Ishmael, and then you created for yourself a world of enemies. Going forward, forgot where I was going with that. Kenizzites, Jethro, Midianites. Well, all right, let's just go forward. So, anyways, Numbers. What does this say? Chapter 116. That don't sound right. This does not sound right at all. Now I'm gonna be. Why would it say? Let's see. Okay, my bad. Let's see. Oh boy, I wrote a note down here that I really do not understand. I know it's not the book of Numbers, chapter 1. I haven't gone to that scripture for a long time. Oh boy. Anyways. Yeah, that's definitely gonna leave me with a doubt. Anyways, well, what could I do? Yeah, just forgive us for that. I'm think that, that kind of just doesn't throw me off, but I'm gonna be like in doubt as to what that even meant. Oh well, be it as it is. Let's go to. It's like I'm beginning to remember, but no, I'm not. Okay, the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 30, 34, verse 3. Book of Deuteronomy, chapter, what did I say? 34, verse 3. This is what it reads. Actually, yeah. And all Naphtali, and the land of Ephraim and Manasseh, and all the land of Judah to the utmost sea, and the south, and the plain of the valley of Jericho, the city of palm trees, to Zohar. Why did I read this? And Moses went up from the plains of Moab to the mountain of Nebo, to the top of Pisgah, that is over against Jericho. And the Lord shewed him all the land of Gilead to Dan, and all of Naphtali and Ephraim, okay, to the land of Judah to the uttermost, and to the south, the plain of the valley of Jericho, and the city of palm trees, Well, because we just read that they went along with them, you know, the Kenizzites, I think, or the Kenites went along with them from that point on. And there is a point. See, that's what messed us up. That's why we were kind of disappointed that we didn't recognize that we recognized we made a mistakes in our notes. Anyways, well, be that as it may, there was a connection to be brought forth concerning that. But nonetheless, let's go forward to the book of Numbers, chapter 10, verse 11, the which reads, "And it came to pass," is this it? Yeah, "and it came to pass on the 20th day of the second month, in the second year, that the cloud was taken up from off the tabernacle, the testimony." See, even this is wrong. I don't know what's going on. I must be really sleepy. Maybe it was because I was trying to say that they marched forward from Sinai to Kadesh Barnea. Kadesh was where the Kenites separated, but not all of them. It doesn't mean that all of them separated. It means that Heber separated. And we know what happened. It wasn't a separation of like, oh, apostasy or whatever. Now it has been since 1974. But it was a salvation plan in the sense that then Jael, you know, she hammered a nail through Sisera's temple. You know, blessed above all tents, all women. I think that's what Deborah sang concerning Jael, you know, and that blessing. So the woman smites the serpent. I mean, same thing, you know, overcomes the dragon and brings forth the man child that is to, you know, be caught up to Jah's throne, the throne of David, and rule all nations with the rod of iron. So having said that, let's just go forward to verse 29. And actually, you know, to consider that the tribe of Judah is because now their march is before all of them. So now, "And Moses said to Hobab, the son of Raguel." So wait a minute, is Hobab the father-in-law of Moses? Here it says that Hobab is the son of Raguel, the friend of Abraham. Why is he a friend of Abraham? Because of his grandfather Abraham, he was taught to be a friend of Abraham, you know. So he taught his house well, basically, and through Keturah, you know, descend the Midianites. So the Midianites, Raguel, the Midianite. Wasn't his name Jethro? Well, you know, it's establishing here a relationship. The name, the named. He's under the authority, obviously. He's a friend of God, just like Abraham. He's a Midianite, just like the children of Abraham with Keturah. He is Hobab. He is loved, beloved, but that's actually the children of Moses. He's kept hidden in the heart, basically. Who knoweth the heart but him that is the spirit which is within all men? And then he's Moses' father-in-law, so that means that Moses' father is actually Raguel, the friend of God, Abraham. Moses' father is actually a Midianite, Keturah and Abraham. Moses' father-in-law is Jethro, the priest of Midian. Jethro, his excellency, priest of Midian. And, you know, Moses' father-in-law, according to the law, according to the flesh, is who else? It's Yatar. It's the remnant, the leftovers, the hanging over. So we see a continued like progress concerning this fact. So now I do again mention that Hobab is code for the, you know, the lineage that Moses signs over to Jethro. Therefore, in the book of, I think it was Judges or perhaps Joshua, no, Judges. Therefore, you know, the Kenites are counted for children of Hobab, father-in-law of Moses. No, they're children perhaps of Moses, but signed away through the bill of divorce to Jethro or to Raguel or to Reuel or to priest of Midian or to the man or to the priest of Midian. Oh, I think I said priest of Midian or to Jethro or to the or you know the Midianite, that all these kind of names. We are journeying to the place of which the Lord said, "I will give it you. Come thou with us, and we will do thee good."
and the Lord, for the Lord hath spoken good concerning Israel, and he said to him, I will not go, but I will depart to my own land and to my kindred. Now a lot of people think, see, he left. Well, keep reading. And he said, leave us not, I pray thee. When has Moses not received a prayer from the Most High, right? For as much as thou knowest how we are to encamp in the wilderness, and thou mayest be to us instead of eyes. And it shall be, if thou go with us. So he's trying to, you know. And they departed from the mount of the Lord 3 days. So they departed. They never left. They never, you know, they stuck together. And then we go forward. And it says, you know, it talks about the ark and stuff like that, which can be in turn connected to Psalm 68, verse 31. Let's see. Should we continue? Yeah, I think we should continue. I mean, might as well wrap this up. So, see, just really briefly, I'm not even going to go into detail concerning this. Chapter 12, the book of Numbers. And Miriam and Aaron spake against Moses because of the Ethiopian woman whom he had married. For he had married an Ethiopian woman. What does this mean? There's a redundancy. There's a circle going on. There's an expression that's being duplicated. Torah does not waste time or word or space with words that are unnecessary. Moses, you know, spake against Moses because of the Ethiopian woman whom he had married. For he had married an Ethiopian woman. They were hating on her. Why? Because Hashetan is from within. You know, still to this very day. Why can't we accept Ethiopia? Because we're haters. That's why. And it's got nothing to do with the flesh. Because Ethiopians are black, right? So what's wrong with receiving black people? Don't black lives matter? Nah, it's just a hater thing. It's just that we hate, you know, on each other. Why her? Why Ethiopians? They were hating on them because Ethiopians got saved first. That's why. We'll go into detail, you know, hopefully during this video, a little bit on the forward. So basically, Josh shuts their mouth up and it's all like, listen, when I talk to this prophet or something, I'll talk to him in parables and dark speeches and dark sayings and proverbs. I'll talk to him in dreams. It's not so with Moses. What makes you think that Moses is doing his own will? He's actually doing my will. You wouldn't know that, right? But why don't you fear to speak against my chosen? You think he don't know what he's doing? I tell him what to do. He's faithful to me. You know, I speak to him face to face, clearly. You know, without no parables, nothing. I tell him, what's up? And you are being Hashetan to me. You are trying to stir up the fire. You are trying to stir up and get to Moses to break, utilizing, going in circles, which is unnecessary concerning what I told him to do. Marry an Ethiopian. I actually did it for that same purpose, to stimulate zealous or jealousy within you. For you have made me jealous, going whoring to other gods. See how it feels? Basically, kind of like that. Anyways. The key word here that is not translated is yud. It's like a stick the witch once could brand. It's a fire stick. They were stirring the pot, trying to heat up the fire, trying to accuse the faithful brethren, Ethiopia, trying to brand on Moses their wickedness. What could we connect with this? Well, the rod, it's a staff, it's a rod. The branch, they did not like the branch, just like they don't like Yeshua, HaMashiach, because we are haters. We hate ourselves, and therefore we are evil to ourselves. So basically, let's go to Zechariah real quick, just as quickly as possible. I think it was chapter 4. Prophet Zechariah. Chapter 3. And he shewed me Yeshua. Yahshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord, and Shaitan, standing at his right hand to resist him. And the Lord said to Satan, the Lord rebuke thee, O Satan. Even the Lord that hath chosen Jerusalem rebuke thee. Is not this a brand plucked out of the fire? So basically, it's like, okay, Hashetan, okay, Miriam and Aaron, you've been going around in circles hating the Ethiopians. Now I've tested them. Now I've tried them. Can you say that they have not been through the experience that you have been? No, you can't. So shut up. I've tried them. They're branded. They're mine. They've been. You stirred up the fire. I put them in the pot. They burned, but they're still alive. Behold, you know. So shut up. The same word is used. Have I not branded them? The same word is hewed, a pointer, piercing one another, picking at one another like a thorn in one side, just trying to instigate problems because you hate him, trying to stir the pot, you know, trying to fan the fire, accusing the brand. Why do you marry an Ethiopian? Why do you have to marry an Ethiopian? Why an Ethiopian? Why an Ethiopian? You know? And so Hashetan, by that time, you know, in the book of Zechariah, it's done. It's like, okay, I've tried the Israelites, I've tried the Ethiopians. Can you shut up now? So that's basically what's coming down. And then later on, you know, this same chapter goes on to the branch. And then that's when we learn, because it's not our righteousness, it's his righteousness. And righteousness, it's not a personality, it's not a character, it's a person. And how, and the King of Kings of Ethiopia, Haile Selassie I, he chose Jesus Christus. This is why, this is what makes me want to follow Jesus Christ. That's what he said. So basically, we have to follow Jesus Christ. That's his righteousness. That is the cause that is just, which his majesty has established to us as head. So we completely against this, but when we get our acts together, then we're like Paul and we turn to it. So having said all of that, that's basically just, I mean, there's a whole lot more to it, but that's just basically like, you know, real briefly, I mean, concerning that matter. So now the Yud, you know, instead of teaching with one another, we decided to pierce and poke at one another. So Exodus, you know, there's a reference in our notes concerning the book of Exodus, the throne, the hidden throne. We've mentioned that. We really don't feel like going to it right now. So we're just gonna go to Exodus chapter 2 and watch. This will be a little bit interesting. Chapter 2, verse 11, the which reads, you know, Moses identifies himself with Israel, actually. Well, it's not verse 11. I thought I wanted to speak about that, but Moses tried to go to his brethren and do it by force. It's not going to work like that. So then that's why he smites an Egyptian. See, I'm really for the fact that Jah probably revealed himself to Moses, like when he became when he grew up. When it says that you know he grew up and the child grew, that means that he became a man. That you know that means that he matured. He received a message, so he goes to identify Moses, that is, to his Israelite family. Why? Because he learned something, but he wasn't told to go there. I could almost like assure everyone, although I have no evidence to establish that fact. I base my standing on just like the patterns of John. You know, he tells you don't go to your brethren, and we go. So that's, you know, that's kind of like what I'm thinking. And why do I know this? Well, why should Moses have killed anyone unless Jah had to get him out of there somehow? That's usually how it works. Because whatever we're told to do, be sure that we do not do it. You know, so, okay, you want to stick around? They're not going to listen to you. Okay, kill that Egyptian. Now run. Now you got to leave. Now you got no choice. I need you out of there. First, you had to go to the mount and learn some things. Then you could have saved them. You can't save them without leaving Egypt and worshiping me out in the desert in spirit and truth and up in the highlands. You know, so that's basically the pattern. I mean, to add to that, when Jah told him, I'm gonna send you know, to go save your brethren. Oh yeah, whoever you're gonna send, send. I said I was gonna send you. Now you're just making me angry. So, you know, just to add to the fact that we rebellious always from the beginning, don't matter who we talking about. Anyways, going forward, actually what we're looking for is I really don't feel like going into details. Oh, watch. Okay. Book of Exodus, chapter 2. Verse 23. And it came to pass, in process of time, that the king of Egypt died, and the children of Israel sighed by reason of the bondage, Abodah. And they cried, and their cry came up to God by reason of the bondage. This is what it says in the Hebrew. It begins with this. It doesn't say like process of time. It says eighth. It says eighth. It's the Hebrew Concordance 1992. It's as to say they too. Ye too, Ethiopian, shall be smite, shall be smitten with my sword. Have we not been smitten with this sword? Have we not been cut off, but not completely? Have the Ethiopians been cut up? Cut off? Yeah, kind of. You know, but not completely. So it's what it's referring to. It doesn't say in the process of time. It's because eighth, in a way, there's another eighth, the which can be attributed to like a certain time, a certain date, a certain like an appointed time. But in this case, it's the H in 1992, which is in turn to be interpreted as they also. So Israel also, at their appointed time, when the king of Egypt died, the children of Israel sighed by reason of the bondage. Why is it saying that they too? Well, because they too will be saved by the same one that saved. Who are the other ones? Are ye not as children of the Ethiopians to me, saith Yahweh? That's the other ones. They too, H 1992, 8th, with the Ein Tau, are ye not? No, so that you can be to us instead of eyes, Ein, and we will be instead of Aleph, we will be Et, we will be the mouth that testifies, you will be our eyes, and we will be one flesh, and we will have the audiovisual, the double teaching of peace, the Yerushalayim, you know, the double teaching. Audio video, we will have two or more witnesses and we will be one. So we need each other. Now, the reason I say that is because who are the other ones that were saved by Moses? Well, you know, the Ethiopians. And the shepherds came and drove them away, but Moses stood up and helped them and watered their flock. Moses to the rescue. Later on it says, and he said to his daughters, and where is, no, verse 19, and they, no, verse 18, and when they came to Reuel, their father, he said, how is it that ye are come so soon today? And they said, an Egyptian delivered us out of the hand of the shepherds, and also drew water enough for us, and watered the flocks. And he said to his daughters, and where is he? Why is it that ye left the man? Call him, that he may eat bread, that we can talk about Christ. Let us study Torah. Why do you let him go? He saved you from an Egyptian? An Egyptian saved you from the downpresser? That's no Egyptian. That's prophecy. So that's pretty much basically you know what, I'm kind of tired. I'm just going to pause. Anyways, this thing's going to turn off perfect time. Shalom.